Well, I'm delighted to be here, and you folks are going to be sort of the guinea pig for this talk. I haven't given this before, and I think you'll find it to be fairly broadly based and somewhat eclectic in its focus. So I would hope that you would stop and ask questions along the way. I'd be more than happy to entertain those, or if you'd prefer, you know, wait to the end and we can talk about them then. A little background on the kind of the origins of this work. I've been working for about a year, year and a half with the Institute of Medicine with a forum that they have ongoing. And the charge of this forum is to really look at a couple of questions. You know, one is, what do we know about quality improvement in healthcare organizations, and in particular, what impact it's actually having in the area of quality? And the second question relates to why aren't these scientifically validated and demonstrated best practices in the area of quality improvement being taken up at a greater rate than they are in healthcare organizations? So this forum is really concerned with both of those questions. And what really hit home to me in terms of kind of thinking about these issues was kind of a figure that I read the other day, and that is that since 1950, the NIH has been funded to the tune of $250 billion. And this group and myself got to thinking about, well, have we gotten our money's worth for this $250 billion in terms of the actual impact that this work has had on healthcare and healthcare delivery? So really big questions, but these are some of the things that I was kind of interested in pursuing. So my role with the forum is really to kind of help them think about quality improvement from a research perspective, talk about engage them in conversation about implementation of quality improvement and best practices in healthcare settings, and possibly make some recommendations about the direction in which both research and practice should go in this area. So big agenda, and I'll probably touch on all of these topics to a greater or lesser degree in the next hour or so. So these are the goals I have for this afternoon. First is to identify what I think are the salient problems with quality improvement research, and really why it hasn't contributed the way we would like to systems change and systems improvement in healthcare delivery. I also want to talk about implementation research, and as I said here, the good, bad, and the ugly. As I'll try to make a case for in a few minutes, these two areas are highly interrelated, and I'll explain why I think that to be the case shortly. And then finally, I want to make a couple of admittedly modest proposals for the ways we can improve research both in the quality improvement area and in the uptake of quality improvement research in healthcare settings. So again, big agenda. I hope we can get through this. We all know about the Institute of Medicine's report on quality and patient errors. There's no point in kind of going over that in great detail. But the issue for the field is the following. There's been billions of dollars invested in clinical research with the idea of improving the delivery and practice of healthcare in healthcare organizations. But there are incredible challenges facing the field with respect to leveraging this research as far as improving quality is concerned. So what we set out to do initially is to really ask the question, you know, looking at the research literature on quality improvement, what is it telling us? You know, how is it related to actual improvements in quality of care, very broadly defined? What are the strengths and weaknesses of this body of research, and what might we do to kind of improve the state of the art, if you will, in quality improvement research. And I have to say parenthetically that this was a fascinating process for me. I mean, I had preconceived notions about what quality improvement research was, but a lot of them were kind of dispelled when I looked at this research collectively, and these are some of the things I want to share with you. Now, I'm not going to go over the entire review with you. What I'm going to do is sort of highlight things that I think are kind of interesting and which might have implications for the implementation of this type of work in practice settings, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to give you a very condensed and highly annotated version of what we found. So this is kind of an example. What we tried to do is, first of all, categorize the types of quality improvement interventions that we found in the literature. And this was much harder than we initially expected to be because there's incredible definitional and operational inconsistency in this area. So we basically had to create our own classification scheme. So you can see down here what some of these categories were. We have a category in information and technology, evidence-based medicine, case and disease management, multidisciplinary teams, et cetera, et cetera. We think that this classification scheme is reasonably comprehensive, although I would stop short of saying that it is exhaustive. And just to give you an illustration, this illustrates both the number of studies that we uncovered in each of these areas and what we call this kind of the success rate, that is the number of studies in which a positive and statistically significant relationship with some quality-related outcome was found. So you can see, for example, that in this chart, patient education and task integration tended to be somewhat less successful than interventions based around data and feedback, case and disease management, and evidence-based medicine. And we went through a fairly laborious exercise in terms of trying to kind of assess the literature in this fashion. And I think I should stop here and just give you a sense of how we've defined quality improvement, because again, I mentioned that there are a lot of definitional inconsistencies here. We took a very, very broad approach, and we define quality improvement as a purpose of action for improving the processes and outcomes of healthcare. And this would include increasing value, improving responsiveness to customers and consumers, improved outcomes in the areas of safety, effectiveness, timeliness, patient-centeredness, equity and efficiency, reducing variation in outcomes, organizational adoption and implementation of continuous improvement methods, and ongoing operation. Whew, says a lot. But the point here is that we did take a very broad brush approach to quality improvement in our assessment. So what are some of the things we came up with? I'm not going to, again, cover the entire assessment, but one of the things is that we clearly found that some types of QI interventions were tended to be more consistently associated with improvements in quality than others. And I'll mention a few of those in just a second. Secondly, we found that the success rate for improved quality outcomes tended to be associated by the type of outcome being examined, and maybe more importantly, by the context, the organizational context in which the quality improvement was introduced. So, for example, and this is probably not too surprising, we found that outcomes related to mortality and morbidity and even patient safety were less frequently associated with these QI interventions than some of the other outcomes. Somewhat surprising, we also found that outcomes that we classified as process-related outcomes, that is, processes that were associated or thought to be associated with better outcomes, were also experienced a much lower success rate than other types of outcomes. And I want to come back to this point a little bit later because I think it has implications for the implementation side of this story. When we looked at the literature a little more closely, there were some very interesting revelations that we uncovered with respect to these types of studies in general. And I just want to share a couple of these with you. This next slide is a little dense, but basically the takeaway here, this sort of describes the sample size, the organizational sample size for these quality improvement studies, and we broke it down by hospital, nursing home, physician practice, and other types of delivery organizations. By far, most of these studies have been conducted in hospital settings. But you'll notice something interesting, that the median sample size is one. That means the almost half of these, or actually more than half if you really want to count them, have a single, they're single hospitals for single organizational studies. Okay, so what are the implications of that? Well, one is that it's virtually impossible to incorporate context as an analytic variable in these studies. So the only way the settings have been used in many of these studies is simply to describe the study setting. You know, typically it's a large university teaching hospital. Okay, but analytically, it's incredibly difficult to incorporate the organizational context or the setting as an important analytic variable in these studies. And you can see that even if you look at it overall, across all types of organization, the median sample size is only two. So one could argue that a lot of these studies are case studies. You know, they're studies in one organization with very little information on which to base decisions about whether these practices, however effective they might be in the study site, might be effective or not effective in other settings. Okay, so that was one of our surprises. The other set of findings, and maybe this is not that surprising, had to do with how the findings of the study related to the type of research design. And you know, this compares randomized controlled trials with observational studies. We actually thought that we found that there were more randomized controlled trials than we initially expected to see. And as this slide, I think, demonstrates, that the relative rate of positive findings was much lower in randomized controlled trials than it was in observational studies. And I'll get back to this point in a second when I talk about a kind of a general critique of the literature. And then we did the same sort of thing in terms of looking at the design of the studies, and we compared cross-sectional studies with longitudinal studies, and essentially the same pattern exists. Those that employed a longitudinal design tended to have less, quote, successful outcomes than those that employed a cross-sectional design. Okay. And so one takeaway from this might be that, well, the more, quote, rigorous the design, the harder it is to really demonstrate positive outcomes from these QI interventions, even though the vast majority of the studies done in this area are observational studies, for example. Any questions about what I've covered so far? Yes.
Is there a certain control trials for this?
It's a great question, and if I could just beg off for a couple slides, I'll cover that. And if I don't, you'll let me know. But yeah, I mean, you're actually setting me up for one of the punchlines, and that is, you know, do we really need to think in very different terms about how this type of research is conducted? The research that we uncovered to date, I would say, has conformed to some very traditional design approaches, and we may need to think out of the box with respect to these types of studies. I saw another hand. Rebecca. A lot of the studies were done at, I would call, the subunit level. Let's say if the hospital was the setting, they might be conducted in the ICU. But it was rarely the case that, except for, I think, the randomized control trials, that more than one unit was used. So yes, it somewhat modifies my statement about, well, these are case studies, because they did sometimes incorporate more than one subunit, but not many and not often is the way I would answer that question. Yes?
Sorry, you said this,
we're
just looking at publishers.
Yeah, it's a very good point, and we sort of noted this on our report to the IOM. I mean, you could call it sort of a publication bias against only accepting things that have a demonstrable or statistically significant outcome associated with them. But in a way, you can also make the argument that these numbers may, or the numbers I displayed earlier, might be somewhat inflated to the extent that if studies were conducted where no outcome or no significant result was achieved, chances are either the journal or the investigator might not be as willing or likely to submit to a journal. And that's pure conjecture. I can't quantify that. But yeah, you're absolutely right. We did not look at anything other than the published literature. But I think the point you're raising about, well, is there some sort of bias that's introduced by not looking systematically at the literature that hasn't been published, or the research that hasn't been published? Other questions? Yeah, we actually have done some of that work already. I haven't presented it here. And the other thing I think I had mentioned earlier was that we did find some differences across type of organization. So interesting, I know there are a couple of nursing faculty in the audience. Relatively few of these QI studies have been done in long-term care settings, I guess, and we're really curious as to why that should be the case. It may be a problem of the inability to measure quality in those settings, but relatively, you can see that among the relationships we examine, I'm sorry, this slide doesn't say it, but take my word for it, relatively few were done in nursing home settings, and we're still trying to figure out why that would be the case. Maybe we can come back to that later. But yeah, Daniel, I think your point is right. Although there does come a point where, you know, your cell sizes become so small that you're reluctant to draw, you know, any meaningful conclusions when you parse the data out that way. We can do it with hospitals, for example, and with certain types of QI interventions, but it doesn't work with all of them simply because of the low numbers, so I would put it. Okay, so here are some other findings. Actually, some of these I've already touched on. We found that multifaceted interventions were less frequently associated with improvements in quality. And by multifaceted interventions, talking about, for example, the introduction of a new evidence-based practice into a hospital unit, coupled with physician education to orient them to this practice, coupled with kind of process changes that would involve, say, nursing or ancillary care staff that would support these new practices. In almost all cases, we found that these types of multifaceted or multidimensional interventions were less associated with positive outcomes than those that focus on a single dimension of quality improvement. Yes, Daniel. You set me up too, because you know I'm presenting these findings to, because I think they all have implications for the implementation side or the organizational side of this type of work, and I completely agree with your interpretation. You know, with multifaceted interventions, you've got more going on. It's more difficult to ensure fidelity to the original kind of strategy or QI intervention, and I think it's really, frankly, much more difficult to even determine whether all the components have been implemented successfully. So I mentioned the second one already. Improved quality outcomes vary by outcome and a type of organization in which the QI change was introduced. And what this says to me is that, particularly on the type of organization, is that context does matter in some way, although the context was not specifically examined as an analytic variable in these studies. But we think that this set of descriptive findings sort of lends itself to, at least to that notion. I'll come back to that in a second. And then finally, the point I already made, more rigorous designs are more likely to achieve findings of no difference. So if we took the 35,000-foot view, what can we say about the state of quality improvement research? Okay. The first thing that I would kind of advance is that a lot of them are done with single organization samples. And I think the implications here are several. One is that it really does limit the ability to generalize the findings to other organizations of the same type or different types. And secondly, it effectively precludes including context as an important analytic variable in these studies. And if you read the organization's literature, everyone talks about context. But if you look at the research literature, very little of it has explicitly examined context other than, as I said, to simply describe the study setting. Peggy. I'm sure that a lot of the hospital-based studies were based in system studies, but the authors didn't acknowledge that or recognize that as an important variable. So in some cases, I would actually do a little primary research myself to see whether or not these hospitals were system affiliated. But the takeaway point here is that to the authors, and a lot of these are physicians, I don't mean to be disparaging, they don't care or weren't cognizant of this or didn't view this to be an important variable in the study. The second thing we noted is that a lot of this work is not funded. And here's a typical scenario. You have a physician working, let's say, in a, I don't know, an ICU or something like that. And he or she says, well, we're implementing this new kind of process improvement next month. Let's take advantage of this and kind of do an evaluation. And so they design a study. Sometimes it can be just a simple before and after design. Sometimes they might have a comparison group, another ICU that they can draw on. But a lot of it's sort of what I call opportunistic, as opposed to kind of systematic and planned. And I think that the upshot of this is that both the time duration and the care with which these studies are designed often leaves something. It's lacking. Let's put it that way. So you can't blame an assistant professor in a large university teaching hospital for wanting to get publications, but it does have an impact on the work in QI. A lot of the studies are of very short duration. In other words, the typical scenario is that you'll do a baseline assessment of whatever outcome you're interested in, patient safety or mortality or morbidity. You'll introduce the intervention, might be a process improvement. You'll take a post-intervention assessment of the outcome of interest, and then you'll write up your results. Often this is done within the space of 6 months to a year at most. And for those of you who are familiar with organizations, you know that change of any type has the propensity of kind of experiencing entropy, and systems go back to their previous state. And it's really a glaring omission in this body of research that the studies are not of sufficient duration to determine whether these changes, however effective they might be in the short term, have any sustainable qualities. And I know that the IOM group in particular is interested in this question, and were very frustrated when I told them that, the research out there doesn't really lend itself very well to answering these questions about sustainability. No replication of studies. Okay, what's the big deal here? Well, I mentioned that almost all these studies were done in single organizational settings. And, you know, this is fine. You do clinical trials. You typically do them in small with small samples. But the way you determine generalizability is that you do them over. You replicate them with other samples and in other settings. There's virtually no replication of this type of research that I could recognize. It might be out there, but I couldn't recognize it as such. And of course, that really limits your ability to A, generalize your findings, and to maybe to determine whether or not context matters in any kind of rigorous way. And that leads me to this point. No explicit consideration of context. I mentioned this, I guess, repeatedly. And that is, other than to describe the study setting, there's no recognition that context could make a difference in terms of either implementation or how effective the intervention actually is. And then finally, virtually none of the studies make any mention of implementation. In other words, a typical scenario is that we introduced this process change in the ICU. We assessed what impact or relationship it had on quality of care before and after. But there's no recognition or no empirical demonstration that the process change was implemented or how well it was implemented. So, what do we take away from this? Okay. So this is what I told the ILM. We have only a limited understanding of what works, when it works, and or where it works. And I think I'm pretty confident in those and making those statements, even though it was really depressing for me to convey this message to the ILM when I talked to them last month. But this kind of segues into the next part of my talk, which is to really talk a little bit about implementation, because I think... I think the more appropriate question is, how much of my pay are they going to take away for having reached this conclusion? So other than this kind of depressing message, I think we're in great shape. Yes? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So within each of the categories we specified, there was a lot of variation in terms of what they actually implemented. But we couldn't look at each individual study and make some overall assessment, so we really had to come up with our own taxonomy or classification scheme. But to answer your question directly, yeah, there was a lot of variation even within these categories that we noted.
So some might have used Plan New Study Act or...
Yeah, so, yeah, absolutely.
So the implementation question, I'll segue to your next point. That's where I would be fascinated by the implementation, the variation in what they did.
Right, and that's what I'm going to talk about now, is the implementation. So thanks again for setting me up. A lot of it tended to be strictly empirical and, as I said, opportunistic. You said, well, the hospital is going to be doing X. We're going to look at this in terms of how it's going to affect patient outcomes. And that's what I mean by opportunistic. They really didn't have the time or the funding or maybe the inclination to kind of think, you know, conceptually about what are we looking at here and how can we design the study to really ground it in some, you know, solid conceptual or theoretical literature. Other questions? Okay. So let me, before I get into the implementation part, let me just define it in terms of the way we sort of thought about it in this project. We define implementation as the transition period following a decision to adopt a new quality improvement idea or practice when the intended users put that new idea or practice into use. Okay, so that's fairly straightforward, fairly simple definition. Not the only definition that's out there, but it's kind of the one we used. So this is how I would characterize the current thinking about quality improvement and implementation. You know, you do your basic research, your bench research, you kind of develop a treatment protocol around the results of that research. you do efficacy, you know, clinical trials, and you do some, you make some attempt to do effectiveness trials, and then you deploy this, and everyone loves it because it's proved to be related to better quality care. Well, it doesn't work this way, and I think this part is okay. You know, we do a great job on this part, and NIH has spent, as I said, billions of dollars really doing this part. Where the system breaks down is kind of over here, because it's, these practices aren't deployed, at least not deployed to the extent that I think that, I guess, any funding agency would like to see. And this is kind of why I said we need to get beyond the kind of the linear model. You know, unfortunately, yes, Barbara. But we do know a lot about what works at a basic research level, on a treatment level. What we don't know is, again, this side. We don't know how these things work in practice. And I guess that's where, again, that's where the system, I think, breaks down. So it's not the scientific basis for a lot of the protocols or changes, I think, are quite solid. I think that they all at least make a claim that the practices are based on some evidentiary base. Okay, and it really depends on the practice we're talking about. And the articles themselves really test how well these work in a practice setting. I guess that's the way I would characterize it. So this model, I call the linear model, I think actually they didn't like this slide either, but I think actually this is a model that's perpetuated by a lot of the funding agencies that are engaged in this, supporting this type of research. And you know, I've had conversations with staff and in various agencies that says, yes, we really got to do this differently. We really need to kind of rethink this because this isn't working. The problem is that when you go to the review board, the review study sections themselves, they're still thinking in terms of what I would call the kind of the linear model. So in many cases, we have a long ways to go in terms of kind of rethinking this. So what's wrong with the linear model? Okay. There's little emphasis on causal pathways and nested interconnected structures and activities that exist in real-life organizations. There's little influence of organization theory, organizational behavior, and quality improvement studies, as far as I can tell. And there's still, as I suggested earlier, this what I call randomized control trial thinking, and which has the effect of really controlling context away. So you have this very important, potentially important analytic variable that the study designs really discount. And that's what it amounts to. So believe me, I have nothing with no problem with randomized controlled trials. I think they're great for certain things. As I said, they're great for testing efficacy of kind of what I call molar interventions, but they're not so great in terms of assessing process related phenomenon, complex interactions among program components, contextual effects, and kind of implementation studies. And I'll kind of elaborate on this in just a second. So internal validity is really an important goal, but in a way, the way many of these studies are designed, it really obscures or distracts from other kind of equally important issues that are associated with quality improvement research and the implementation of quality improvement practices in organization settings. So my pitch is, what's missing in QI research? You have to buy into these assumptions that healthcare, the majority of healthcare today is provided in an organizational context, that the behavior of clinicians is influenced by the organizations in which they work, and that there needs to be a recognition about the interconnections among components of organizations, teams, hospitals, support systems, and this whole notion of kind of embeddedness. This is kind of what's missing, I think, in a lot of QI research. And why does context matter here? It can affect implementation directly. It can moderate the relationship between a QI intervention and the outcomes of interest, or it can be helpful in terms of establishing the external validity of both implementation and QI research. So take your pick. You can make a case for all of these. But the takeaway point is that not much of this is being done in any form in the literature. There's some real challenges associated with actually pursuing the sorts of things that I displayed on the previous slide. There are a lot of models out there for how to change an organization or how to change the practices. Most of them are untested, and a lot of them have limited generalizability. A lot of them only touch on some very difficult and complex questions of power, control, leadership in organizational settings. And these are kind of soft and squishy and hard to get your hands around, but I think we're learning increasingly that these have a relationship to the ability of the organization to change, and more specifically, to both implement and sustain quality improvement practices. And almost all QI studies neglect the premises of organizational life, which are the inherent conflicts and paradoxes that you find in organizations. Again, this is very, very messy stuff. And one more reason why it doesn't lend itself well to the linear model or the linear thinking or the randomized control type of thinking, that doesn't mean that it's not important, and it doesn't mean it shouldn't be examined. So what is the state of the art then with respect to kind of implementation? I'm moving again from quality improvement research to quality improvement implementation research. I think that there is an emerging list of best practices. I think we're still stuck with this notion of a linear development of quality improvement interventions and the deployment of those interventions. There's lots of anecdotal information out there about what works and maybe what doesn't work, but I don't think it's been approached in a very systematic way. And then there, as those of you who are familiar with this area know, that there are an increasingly large number of models and theories that are being set up to test implementation. Not many of those have actually been put into practice or put to empirical test. So I guess that what I would say here is that, you know, implementation, for obvious reasons, is getting a lot of play and attention. But I think to call this area of research implementation science is probably a bit of a misnomer. I think we're still in the let a thousand flowers bloom stage in terms of we're trying different things. We're not sure what works. We're not sure what theory or approach is best under what conditions. And my sense is that we have kind of a long way to go in this area. This is kind of my model of what I think influences implementation. And it's actually pretty simple, but I think it captures most of the major concepts that both what I think and what the literature suggests is related to implementation. So you have the content of the intervention, which would include the type of intervention, its triability, the amount of evidence based for the intervention. You have the process, that is the procedure or process by which the intervention is introduced in the organization. And maybe most importantly, you have context here. That is the setting or the situation in which the intervention occurs or is introduced. And I've kind of broken this down into external and internal, as you can see here. Now, what I don't know here, and I just don't think that the literature is well developed enough, is how these work in sort of as a system or interactively. I kind of can kind of identify what the individual variables are that are probably important, but how they sort of interdigitate, I think we're really quite far from that point. But I wanted to show this to you because I think it sort of illustrates the way I'm thinking about implementation with respect to the factors or the types of concepts that I think come into play here. And maybe you can help me with trying to figure out, well, how do they really relate to each other? What has to be, for example, let me pose this question. So if you had a knowledge of the internal and external context in which QI intervention or change was designed to be introduced, what would that tell you, if anything, about the sort of process that you might employ to get that successfully introduced? I don't know the answer to that question, but I think it's a question worth exploring. Or, you know, what's the relationship between the content of the intervention and the process that you might employ to introduce that intervention or change in an organizational setting? Again, I don't know the answer to that question. I don't think the literature tells us much yet. But these are the sorts of things I think that should be asked. So let me share with you a couple of findings that we uncovered from our review of the, quote, implementation literature. And again, we sort of categorized these studies by the taxonomy I presented in the previous slide. So we have internal context, external context, process, and content. So I don't know if there's any kind of major takeaways from this slide other than to suggest that, gee, the external context, even though relatively few studies have examined context, so context would include things like the reimbursement environment, the regulatory environment in which the organization operates, et cetera, et cetera. Relatively few of these studies have been done, but they seem to suggest kind of a higher success rate with respect to implementing these changes. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. A lot of the studies have been done on internal context with, as you can see, kind of mixed results. And then you have kind of variation kind of in between. There are a couple gaps in the literature that I want to mention. You know, one is that relatively few of these studies have considered the source of intervention as a major contributor or a potential contributor to its implementation. So these QI practices can come from outside the adopting organization, they can be developed within the adopting organization, or some combination of both. But the literature doesn't seem to have embraced this with any great regularity.
Jeff?
Yes?
Can you talk about the implementation process?
You're right, and that's the way we sort of interpreted it in the report. We said, well, let's take this one, internal context. I mean, you have pretty almost equal results here, both positive and negative results. But all it says is that there are variables within that broad category that can act to either facilitate the implementation of a QI change or to act as a barrier to the implementation of that QI change. And I think that's as far as you can take the interpretation here based on this without going into the individual studies. I think the purpose of the slide was just to give you a sense of kind of the relative emphasis in the literature in these four areas. And as I said, very little on external context, a lot on internal context, and then somewhere in between on these two areas. Two other things that are neglected in this line of research. One is that there's almost no emphasis on kind of social networks in terms of its effect on implementing QI changes. nothing on kind of interorganizational ties, and this might get to your question, Peggy, about whether or not a hospital is a part of a system, whether or not that those sorts of relationships have any bearing on implementation. And, you know, frankly, we're getting really kind of far afield here, but anecdotally, we know that the culture and the history of these organizations with respect to other similar types of changes can very well influence the likelihood of being able to successfully implement a new change. And again, these are just not currently and explicitly incorporated into the research on QI implementation.
Well, I make another observation. When you do the measurement of quality implementation process, for example,
these are relationships, not articles. So a given article might examine, five or six factors potentially related to implementation, and we counted those relationships as opposed to the studies in this slide.
So, regardless of the number of articles, I'm wondering whether there's also an issue that so kind of a silo phenomenon. People working on QI don't talk to people working on implementation.
That's exactly what's happening. When we first went into this project, we thought this was going to be one body of literature. And in fact, it turns out to be two separate and almost mutually exclusive lines of inquiry. You're right. So the implementation folks don't appear to talk much to the QI intervention folks and vice versa. So for example, very few of these studies, the ones I've been referring to as implementation research, actually look at outcomes. They simply stop at the point where the intervention has been implemented or not. You're right. So they're operating on parallel tracks. There doesn't appear to be much dialogue or discussion between them. In fact, that was kind of one of my recommendations, is that there needs to be more of this. But it was shocking. In fact, our intention originally was to write one report. We couldn't, because the literatures were so distinct, we ended up writing essentially two reports. Yes? Yeah, it could be, well, it really could be anything. It could be implementing a new evidence-based medicine practice, or it could be implementing a process change in a med-surg unit. It could be implementing a new clinical procedure based on solid research findings. I mean, you could really run the gamut in terms of the. But what all of them have in common is that they all are at least ostensibly. They should be ostensibly associated with improvements in quality.
How is that different from quality improvement?
Quality, okay. An example of quality improvement research would be that, let's just use kind of evidence-based medicine, for example. And you might have, let's say, a unit in the hospital that says, we're going to test this new evidence-based practice in terms of how it affects patient outcomes, and that could be, could be a rate to recovery, it could be readmission rates, it could be any quality-related outcome. But what they don't do in these studies is they simply describe the intervention. They don't describe how it was implemented or whether or not it was implemented successfully or completely. The emphasis is really on the outcomes, not on assessing the intervention per se. And that would be the distinction I would make. Am I making that clear? Is that or clearer?
I think so. I agree with you then that it seems crazy that those are separate because it's all the same.
Seems crazy to me.
Process.
Yeah. All right, so another hand? No? Okay, this is just, we broke down the, what is this, the internal context into subcategories. So we have culture, climate, resources and support, structure and staffing and workload. And this is just to give you a sense of the challenges we face in terms of kind of classifying these kind of facilitators and barriers to to the implementation of QI. But this will just kind of give you a relative sense of what these studies have shown. And in this case, workload, it's a biggie. It says that essentially that when your workload is excessive, or the higher the workload, the less likely you are to see successful implementation. And the other findings are somewhat more ambiguous based on the comment or the question that Daniel raised. Quite a few studies on culture and climate, resource support, structure and staffing, they've all been considered, but with mixed results. I painted a not very great picture of these two bodies of research, both on the QI side and on the implementation side. So now the challenge is to say, well, what the heck do we do about it? Or is there anything we can do about this to kind of make this research more useful? And I have a couple of ideas. They're all in the formative stage, but let me kind of run a couple by you. One is related to the way we do research, and specifically with the relationship that researchers have to the ultimate utilizers of that research. And all this model is doing, it's sort of a triangle. And those of you who look at kind of study organizations know that it's very similar to kind of a matrix model where there's no kind of hierarchy of authority. So the point here is that the researchers and the theory builders work with the practice types to very closely to both identify the problem that the research is trying to address and to come up with kind of appropriate explanations or theories to kind of guide the solution or the examination of that problem. So the typical model, as you know, is that researchers kind of swoop in from on high and they deductively or not kind of impose kind of a research design and maybe a theoretical framework, or they collect their data and work and go away. Well, one of the reasons that doesn't work, and when I say it doesn't work, there's no uptake on this, is that they really haven't talked to the people who are going to be charged with actually implementing or using that change. I mean, it sort of makes sense here, but I'm suggesting this is a different model for doing research, because typically, again, we take a hands-off approach. We don't want to get contaminated too much with kind of reality. But I think for this type of issue, we do need to change our perspective. We do need to sort of get in the habit of working much more closely with the world of practice, and specifically with those who are going to be utilizing the results of the research. And only in that way, I think, will the problems or the solutions to the problems have real meaning to the folks that are grounded in reality. But at the same time, I think it also lends itself to new ways of thinking about kind of theory, conceptualization, and models. So this can be structured as a win-win situation. These aren't mutually exclusive. These aren't, you choose one, you can't do can't do another. And this is what I kind of meant by when I referred earlier to kind of thinking a little bit differently about this research than the kind of randomized control trial model, or even sort of the purely deductive approach to doing research like this. So this is one suggestion. I'm going to go over this very quickly. I'm not going to do that. The second area where I think we can improve is in our analytic methods. And I think that there needs to be more work done using kind of multi-method approaches and multi-level designs. And in the multi-methods area here, we're talking about combinations of qualitative and quantitative research, combinations of randomized control trials and case studies, process studies and outcome studies. I think that the questions here and the phenomenon that we're talking about here are too messy and too complex for one approach to work exclusively. I think that we really have to start thinking in terms of kind of multiple approaches or multiple analytic methods if we really want to get answers to some of the questions that I had posed earlier. And of course, in terms of multi-level designs, this is intended to emphasize the importance of kind of assessing context and the role that context plays in both shaping the outcomes of QI interventions and in terms of shaping implementation of QI interventions. There are lots of good methods that are being developed, some of which were developed at the University of Michigan, I had to put in a plug, that really would allow us to kind of get a much better handle on how context influences both the outcomes and implementation process. And the next to last point I want to make here is that we need better conceptual work done on distinguishing between what are seemingly related phenomenon, and here I'm talking about the differences between the adoption of a change, the implementation of a change, the diffusion of the change, and ultimately the kind of the institutionalization or sustainability of that change. I think the literature kind of mixes all these up in a fairly undifferentiated way, and we need to think much more clearly and rigorously about the factors that would influence, say, implementation and how they would differ from the factors that would influence diffusion or sustainability. I just don't think we're quite there in terms of our thinking. And then the last thing I want to talk about is capacity. How do we develop the capacity for doing this type of research better? One of the things we need is better data. For example, there's very little publicly available data out there that would allow us to assess the important contextual characteristics of organizations that might influence either the outcomes or the process of implementation. And there needs to be some kind of infrastructure in that arena. That needs to be given much more attention. Funding, I alluded to this earlier. A lot of study sections at NIH are still thinking in the randomized control trial mode. And I'm convinced that over time that will change. But until that does, it's unlikely that there's going to be a huge amount of funding for this type of research. Greater use of multidisciplinary teams. We talked earlier about how the QI effectiveness folks aren't talking to the QI implementation folks. Well, I think a lot could be accomplished if you simply got physicians, organizational behavior folks, good statisticians or methodologists in the same room, all kind of talking to each other about this kind of common set of objectives or goals. Not happening yet. My hope is that it will in the future. Fourth point, start thinking about making implementation actually part of the intervention. We mentioned earlier that most intervention studies or effectiveness studies on QI don't consider implementation specifically. Well, why not incorporate that part as part of the intervention? So, for example, you would look to see about how well the change or intervention was being implemented as a component of that quote experiment or study, in addition to kind of examining how well it's related or associated with the quality outcomes. Bring in the users of innovation. I mentioned this when I talked about the engaged scholarship model. Really talk to the people who are going to be using the results of this study so that the study design, the framework on which it's based, really is relatable to those that are going to be using the research. More long-term studies are needed. I mentioned that part of the problem with the QI research is that very short duration. We don't know whether these findings or these results are going to stick in the long term. And it's really their sustainability that is the bottom line question here. We need more long-term studies on this. And then finally, I mentioned that the implementation science, I think, is still in a very formative stage of development. And I think there's still a lot more room for some basic research on implementation and implementation processes before I would suggest that this area is really kind of a science. But I think it's probably kind of worth the long-term investment. So I will stop here. Any questions, comments? Yes. Yeah, you know, one thing we didn't do in this review is we didn't review the work outside, quality improvement. We didn't really look at the conceptual work. There were something like 200 studies that we reviewed under the QI effectiveness work, and something like 100 under the implementation work. So yeah, granted, we didn't cover all the bases. We tried to maintain some focus, but yeah, I definitely think there's some value and some learning that could be achieved by looking at some of the work done in other areas, such as the example you gave. I knew you had another question.
Two.
Two. Yeah, I would tend to agree, and I also have some anecdotal information to kind of support what you're saying. I think, you know, when we talk to people, to docs, for example, who are either working in a managed care setting or even just in a regular kind of clinical setting, you know, what they say is, yes, we are very interested in improving the quality of care. That's why we went into this business. We strongly believe that we want to give the best care possible for our patients. However, I have 11 minutes to see each patient, which includes writing up my notes on that and that encounter. So we wanted to make these changes, but they use the metaphor. We want to go to the cupboard. We don't want to have to go to the supermarket. Yeah. That's what they say. And I think that's a very, very telling comment. And it just sort of reinforces what I think my point about how context is so important in terms of its impact on the implementation or the uptake of some of these prescribed or best practices.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we did for their patient population.
But this would get back to Daniel's point, I think. And by having some dialogue between the potential users of these practices and those that are doing research on this, you know, you could have recognized that and said, well, look, we need to take a different approach here, or we need to take an approach that will fit within the context of your practice, as opposed to assuming, which I think the literature does now, that just because these practices have been, quote, scientifically demonstrated to be to improve quality of care, that clinicians will gravitate to these and there will be automatic uptake. We know that that's not true now. I mean, less than 50% of these new practices are actually being utilized in kind of real world settings. So, I mean, I use that as sort of ammunition for getting back to your point about the need to kind of engage with the users of this work, of this research, in terms of designing the study and even asking the questions, even asking the right questions.
Rigorous research.
I don't think it's rigorous research, and we're always looking for rigorous research. I think the issue is more, should we publish null findings? And I think that is more problematic here. And I'm not putting the blame entirely on the journals or on editors or former editors like me. I think it lies with the researcher as well, because I think in many cases they say, we didn't find anything here. It's not worth pursuing. I'm not going to submit it for publication. I personally believe that if the study is done well, that null findings are just as interesting and as important as statistically significant findings. A lot of it depends on how you pose the question, how you pose the research question. Yes? No, it's not the number of studies. In this case, it's the number of relationships examined. So in any given study, you might have more than one relationship.
108 resource support measures.
Are you talking about here? It's a number of relationships examined between some aspect of resource support and the success or lack of success of implementing a QI change.
So each of those studies, though, would have, or each of those measures studied, would have had a sample size for assessing it. So another way to present, it's, your graph gives the 108 measures assessed kind of equal weight, dividing them by whether or not they were found to be statistically significant, positive, negative, or not statistically significant.
Yeah, I get another way of, I think, answering your question is that we didn't really evaluate the individual studies based on their kind of scientific merit or the rigor of their design or even the measures they use. So this for these 108 relationships examined, there could have been 25 different measures or ways of approaching implementation as an outcome. The only thing they have in common is they all looked at implementation as an outcome, measured differently, just as the resources or the way they conceptualized and measured resource support could have been approached very differently.
So, I mean, to some extent, you really would want to incorporate that because the power, like a null study where it's sufficiently powered is an important finding. A null study where it's not sufficiently powered
sure.
is not a good null finding.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's kind of the distinction that at some level we'd like to bring.
Well, yeah, but you know, that would sort of bring us down to such a fine grain level that we would have, again, trouble, I think, looking at the body of work from a 35,000 foot level.
It'd be better to have 108 studies with the same measure.
Yeah, no, that's just part of the problem with the research. I mean, this is our own classification scheme, and we had to come up with it because there's nothing out there in the literature that would help us. You know, you've seen one study. So we had to come up with a way of kind of grouping these studies, even though, as you're suggesting, there's a lot of variation in terms of the measures used, the sample sizes, et cetera, et cetera. So guilty as charged.
Well, I absolutely.
Yeah. Other questions?
Well, thank you all for coming out on a beautiful Friday afternoon, and thank you to
Sure.
Guys.